that are going to be playing here tonight are, it's the core of it, of course, is Mylon LeFevre, but he has a band back in Atlanta, Georgia, named Broken Heart, and they couldn't come out at the last minute, and things turned out, and so we worked it out where the 77s have been rehearsing with him for the last 3 days, and they've put together a set of music, and we're really excited about it. But Mylon has had such an interesting life. I heard about him a couple of years ago. I'd heard about him before, but I did an interview with him for a radio show I was doing called Rock Scope. And in the interview, I found out some things about him that made me appreciate where he has come from and where he is at now. For he started out at 17 years old, and people like Elvis Presley were recording his songs, and Mahalia Jackson, and just different, really well-known people in the music field. And from that, he started his own group, Holy Smoke, even though he'd originally been in a gospel group. And he began playing to just literally thousands of people and has done numbers of records for major record labels. And the respect that he has engendered in the music community can be seen from the people, albums that he's played on. He's played on so many different people's albums, like Leon Russell, Lynyrd Skynyrd. His first group is what is now the Atlanta Rhythm Section. And then the people that have played on his albums, such as Steve Winwood, Eric Clapton, many, many really good musicians in the music field that probably you know of, and they just respected him. But unfortunately, during this period of time, Mylon encountered a really, really heavy drug habit. And it seemed like he practically died several times. And he's definitely come back to life, as you're going to see here tonight. He has a story to tell. So would you welcome Mylon LeFevre.
My prayer one day. Jesus made a way for me. Yes, he did. Yeah. One day the sun refused to shine in that simple heart of mine. I prayed both night and day. My Savior would make my way.
answered my prayer one day. Jesus made a way for me. One day.
Good to be in California. This is the first time I've been to California, AD, for me. So it's different now. Last time I was out here, I think, I got paid about $20,000 to open four shows for The Who in San Francisco. And somebody told me they saw us at a place, San Jose? San Jose, with 10 years after. That's how long. It's been a long time ago. 10 years after, hadn't been together in years. So it's been a while since I've been out here, other than just to record and stuff. So it's good to be really alive and to see the, amen. To see new life everywhere. What this song is about, this song says that, you know, the Bible says that as we live life, you know, that there is a danger to being on this earth. Once God reveals himself to somebody and you realize, you know, he starts that renewal of your mind and that process whereby you become, start coming back alive, you know. The wages of what I used to do are death, and there's a lot of ways to die without being in the dirt. You know, there are different parts of your mind and your lungs. If you take too much cocaine, eventually parts of your lungs start to die. If you take too much heroin, you don't have a sex life anymore. I know not many people discuss that in church, and I don't plan to either. But there's a lot of different ways to die. And the eventual death, you know, is easier to accept than these other ways. And new life, man, what new life is all about for me means that if I'm going to be on this planet for a long time, there's certain warfare that I'm going to be a part of. And I'm glad because a long time ago, that battle was won by Jesus, you know, and I'm his and I don't have to deal with all that. What this song says, amen, what this song says is that I'm no stranger to danger because of, you know, who I am and what I've done and all, but someday I'm going to be.
To your
what's going to separate us that are the body from that situation, right, that's going to make us strangers to danger, is something that I don't discuss very often in public. But boy, one of these days that eastern sky is going to break open. And I don't know when it's going to be, but people that don't know anything about the Lord know this old world can't continue the way it's going. Man, mountains, y'all are closer to it than us, blow up and cover two or three states. And, you know, there's earthquakes, and I was reading this one, planes flying from Japan to England or someplace, two of them now have been blown down by volcanic dust or something. I mean, just miles high, miles high. The earth is freaking. And that's its problem, though. I don't know. You know, I'm a few years old in the Lord, and I don't know a lot of things. I don't know what's going to happen post-trib or pre-trib or any of that stuff, you know. I know that the Lord is renewing my mind like He said He would, but it needs renewing because I really abused it for a lot of years trying to make it quit thinking and just be numb, you know, because I couldn't cope with the world. I didn't know what to do. The people that I really loved, I just couldn't please them. And the people I really wanted to please, I just couldn't please them, man. I just freaked so bad. And only you know how hard you tried. I really tried, and I couldn't do it. And I didn't know. And when I was a little kid, man, my mom and daddy told me Jesus was the Son of God. I believed that. I had my doubts from time to time. You know, people would say things to me, and I'd think about those. But in the midnight hour, I really knew that was the truth. I just didn't know what to do about it. And I tried to be a Christian for a long time. I couldn't handle it. So I didn't know about trusting God. Great. I didn't know about trusting God to make me one. That's how you become a Christian. It's by the power. You know, the kingdom of God is not a matter of words. It's a matter of power. And God can make a Christian out of anyone that trusts Him. So that's what's happened to me, and I'm thankful for it. You know, I know that I'm not going to have to worry about whatever happens at the end of time, because the one that I belong to loves me more than I'll ever know until I get there to be with Him and to hang out with Him. In the meantime, it's been the heaviest 3 years. I didn't know that you could be in love with your wife like I am. And I didn't know that she could be in love with me the way she is. And I didn't know that my relationship with my kid could be so. You know what I mean? Man, and let me tell you something. My mother is happy with me. And I didn't think anybody could please her. Lawrence Welk couldn't please her. You know, the Lord told me one day, He said, man, you're so concerned with whether the record company presidents like your product, and you want to please this one. You want to impress Lewis and Mary, right? In 77, right? I'm an old rock and roller. I'm supposed to know how. I want to impress these guys. What the Lord told me was, man, if you'll just be concerned with me, if you'll seek first the kingdom of God and my righteousness, I'll do such a work in you that everybody will love you. Think about it. It's hot. That's hot. Coming back again. This is called Coming Back Again.
this end is Mike, and this is Jen. This is Mark on keyboards. This is Mark on drums. I would tell you more, but that's all I know. And this is Dean on guitar. My name's Mylon. This is a song about being a child. You know, when the people went to the disciples. That's good. This equipment, man, the more you get, the more it takes, right? You get a computer, and it's supposed to be perfect, but it has to be programmed by a human, right? Oh. We're safe. They'll never take over the world. So the disciples came to Jesus and said, well, you're God, and you're always saying these heavy prayers, right? What do we pray? What is a perfect prayer? If we want to pray, what do we pray? And he gave them the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be. And if you'll study that little prayer, it's a little short prayer, and all of you know it, even if you just know about Jesus but don't even know him, you still probably know that prayer. And if you'll think about it and take it apart, it covers relationship, it covers protection, it covers all kinds of things. This one just says, I'm a child of the Father and I'm really thankful.
Right to your side, and you'll find
About 3 years ago, my father, who was a gospel singer back in the South, and my mom and daddy and my uncle, they sung gospel music for 50 years. They started on the Grand Ole Opry in 1921, and they worked together until almost 60 years. And it was something I grew up in. I grew up around people singing songs about Jesus, right? But when I was a kid, there was a whole lot of singing about Jesus, but it was like a business. And I don't know how to explain it to you. I am in the ministry. I am not in the contemporary Christian music business. If I was doing this for money, I'd still be in rock and roll, making five a day. You know, it's like in those days, I used to make over $5,000 an hour, about $7,000 an hour. That's a year's work now. Dean and I work at a church in Atlanta. We're associate youth ministers at a church. We've just been ordained, in fact, this last year. And I came there after the Lord revealed himself to me. And it was during a time when my father and I were starting to get to know each other a little bit, you know. And I was coming around to the Lord, and I had come out to California in 76. This guy named Buck Herring that produces a group called Second Chapter, he had brought me out to L.A. to sing background on a Phil Kagi album. And I thought at the time, right, I was really wiped out. I thought at the time, oh, he's bringing me out here because my voice is so bad and I'm so good, and I'll arrange the vocals. And of course, they had Matthew Ward. They had some of the best singers in the world there. They didn't need me at all. In fact, I didn't even end up singing that much. And they would get me up every morning and minister to me. I know. They would get me up every morning at 8 o'clock. Now, at the time, I still had to take 3 or 4 Quaaludes to get to sleep at night. I had quit taking heroin, but I was still taking 8 or 10 Valiums a day, you know, and a lot of things for my habits, you know. And so it would take me till 4 or 5 in the morning to get unconscious. And I had got it down, though, to where I would do that at least once a day. And there was a time, I know this really is a boring thing to explain to you, but there was a time when I did so much heroin and cocaine, it was a part of the daily life, that I didn't sleep. I decided sleep was a waste of time, and that you couldn't get as much done if you did it. So I would stay up 8 and 9 days at a time. And so, you know, I had written 1,100 songs during that period. Of course, I couldn't record them all, you know. It was silly to write that many. But I had wrote everything that I had thought about. And there wasn't anything else for me to cover, so I didn't have anything else to say. And that was during the dying stage. You know, at first, sin looks like fun. And I'll just confess to you, it is for a while. For a season, the Bible says. You know, and at the end of that season, what happens is you just start to see it, man. Decay sets in. First time I did some those kind of things with my heroes, with Hendrix and people like that, and boy, I used to think, oh, this is the answer. This is the answer. I won't have to go to sleep anymore. You know, you see people setting out in... You see people on, you just see them in movies, unless some of you guys have been to war. There are people who go to war and they get their leg blown off, right? And they're sitting under a tree. Their compadres drag them up under a tree and pop them up with morphine. And right? And so they just sit there and do whatever they do, you know. In the movies, usually they smoke a cigarette while they're waiting on the bad guys to come kill them, right? But they're not hurting anymore. Now think about it. That's real. Morphine is a derivative of heroin, and yet you can sit there with your arm completely missing and smoke a cigarette and just groove until you die. Now, can you imagine what heroin does to your brain? And you stay up for 8 or 9 days at a time, and you can get so crazy. I mean, you can, you know. Well, I had gotten to the point where I could go to sleep every day anyway. I'd stopped a lot of that, and I thought, and my doctor was telling me, boy, you're a walking miracle, man. I've got you down. You're only doing 3 ludes a day. I'm telling you, I'm showing people I have cured you. Well, 3 ludes a day will make a mule slobber on himself. You know what I mean? And yet, they were telling me, so let me tell you, so I'm out there at Buck Herring's house, and he's getting me up at 8 o'clock. Now, if I don't go to sleep till 5 on 3 ludes, at 8 o'clock, he's pouring coffee in my face and reading me the Gospel of John, right? And I'm thinking, oh, man, Buck, you know, I like to do sessions, but anyway, I came back. I met my father and I didn't talk much during that time, you know. I thought he wanted me to be Lawrence Welk, and I didn't know what to do about that, so we didn't get along very much. I had let my hair grow pretty long, and he didn't like earrings. There was lots of things that we couldn't see eye to eye on. And then my daddy got cancer,
My daddy stopped the road. He had always been on the road all my life. He quit the road. And he started going to church for the first time and sitting out there, because he had always been up here. You know, he had always been taking care of business, the business of the gospel music business. And man, he started going to church and letting the minister tell him the word of God. And the word started doing what it always does. It's the truth, man. It started coming on. The light started coming on his head. And my daddy, and I'll just tell you, he's gone to be with Jesus now, but he was the hardest, coldest man I've ever known. I didn't like him. Now, I loved him, but I didn't like him. And I wouldn't be around him if I could get out of it, and I could, so I did, you know? And so we didn't hang out much. And when he got cancer, he got put on his back, and he started reading the word more. And this hard, cold man, this aggressive, he was a giant too. I was afraid of him when I was a kid. I was afraid of him until he died. I'm being honest with you. And he started sharing with me. And what I saw happen to this man was the meanest guy I'd ever known became the most sensitive, gentle, kind person I've ever known. And I fell in love with him in such a way that I wanted to be like him. And I realized, oh, what's going on here? He's becoming like Jesus. And I went and told Jesus, I said, God, if you can do for me what you did for him, then don't wait until I'm old and dying. Please do it for me today. And he did. And so I started going to this gym where he was. Dina, he had been playing in a group in St. Louis, his own band, and they had just got a recording contract with Elektra, and the Lord God called him out of the world and saved him and filled him with his spirit. So Dean just laid his guitar down for 3 years. He didn't play guitar at all. And he had gone to be a janitor at a church just to seek after God. And I came along there one day to play basketball and try to sweat some of this dope out of me right after the Lord had changed my life and my dad had gone on to be with him. And I came to the gym and he was playing over there. So this is what I saw that night. This is called Guitar Zen.
working on a building.
Foundation.
And I'm holding up the bloodstain.
Holding on.
Better for my Lord.
For my Lord.
I won't never get in time.
Time.
Working on your
yes,
building.
I'm working on a building.
I'm going up to heaven.
Heaven.
Right now to get money.
If you're a plumber,
and you give your life to Jesus, that don't mean you should only work on the sinks of Christians. You know what I'm talking about? If everybody was a preacher, who would put the roof on the church? Gotta have some carpenters. And the gifts of the Lord are all perfect. And some of us have the gift of helping. Some of us have the gift of music. And if you can only rock and roll, if you really do it for Jesus, I ain't talking about for you and Jesus, but for Jesus, then do it good. Do it with excellence as unto Him. Because we're dependent on each other. And if you don't know Him today, then He created this day just for you. Let me tell you what makes a good band, all right? I want y'all to join in the band tonight. First of all, you gotta have a good drummer. Y'all already got that. I hear you going out there. Give me those drums, Mark. Now, if you're gonna be a drummer, here's what drummers do. If you're gonna be a drummer, you can't sit there with your feet still. Drummer's gotta move. Move something. And here's what makes a rhythm fat is the bass, right? That's what you call fat back. Give it to me, Jen. Organ for Mark over here. Give me a little organ, Mark. Throw in a little pinch of guitar, Mike. Now what I want y'all to do, if y'all don't mind, I heard y'all sing so pretty, and I want y'all to help me sing tonight. Here's what Holy God said. You know this house we're talking about? It's just a church. Easy, man. It's just a church. That's all we're talking about. And the church ain't a building, man. It's in the hearts of us. We are the church of God. And you can't build that building, man. Holy God builds that building as we trust Him and obey Him. And all this song says that, Lord, I'm working on your building. I want you to work on mine. It also says if you build your house on the sand, and when the storm comes, but if you'll build your house on the rock, you know who the rock is. Jesus is the rock. That when the midnight hour comes and the storm is raging, and let me tell you, the storm will rage. We've been promised that too. That when the storm is raging, it'll just be all right. We'll be just working on His building. He'll be working on ours. Here's what I want you to sing.
Well, I'm working on your building.
Working on the building.
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 Yeah, I want to hear y'all singing, okay?
He said, I'm working on your building.
Working on the building.
Working on your building.
Working on the building.
Working on your building.
Working on the building.
Working on your building, Lord.
You hear him? You hear him? All right, let's sing it to him, okay?
Working on your building.
Working on the building.
That is not a building we can build. Don't ever kid yourself. You can fast until you starve to death. We have no righteousness. We make each other sick with our hypocrisy. If you knew me well enough and you watched me long enough and close enough, I'd make you sick. For the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, this I know. For the Bible tells me so. Yes, and little ones to him belong. I am weak, but he is so strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, oh, 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 he loves me. Yes, he does. Yes, Jesus. Jesus was walking into the temple in Nazareth, where he came to the village where he was a boy, and he went into the temple and they handed him the book of Isaiah, and he opened it up to the place where it said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has appointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted and to announce that captives shall be released and the blind shall see and that the downtrodden shall be freed from their oppressors and that God is ready to give blessings to all who come to him." And he said, "Today this has been fulfilled." Well, let me tell you, it's been fulfilled again today, because when Jesus said those words and we who read this book, this is not just a book. This is the living word of the living God. And you can go to college forever and all you'll learn to do is survive. You won't learn how to live. If you want to learn to live forever, this is the only book it tells it in. And other than what Cecil B. DeMille would have you to believe, God doesn't make movies and he don't make records. This is the only book he ever wrote, and it's completely 100% true. And what I'm finding from reading it, you know, there's some guys in there walking around with camels and robes and stuff, and I used to think, what's that got to do with anything? You read this book, the character of God will be revealed to you. He'll renew your mind if you need it, and he'll change your life. And I'll tell you, whether you're a Christian or not, let me tell you, man, that's what we need to be. That's what the world's even trying to do, and they don't even know Jesus. Well, I work with some musicians that believe that Sri Chinmoy is God. Pete Townsend believes that Mayor Baba, who died in 1968, was God. And George Harrison believes that Krishna, you've seen the guy with the blue face and all the heads? Think about it. Why not choose a chicken hawk? At least he can fly. And let me tell you, man, there is a Satan. There ain't no doubt about it. And he's alive too. You don't have to worry about him if you're a Christian, though. If you really are born again and you're not playing church, let me tell you, because if you are, Satan, if he can get you to go to a church that don't believe nothing, he'll go with you. And if he can get you to sit around and listen to record backwards when you ought to be out telling somebody about Jesus, he'll sit there and listen to you. With you. What the Lord wants to do today, he just spoke here. And it ain't got nothing to do with me. What the truth is 'cause I read it out of here.